seemed to be born with a desire to sing country music, and she possessed the talent and commitment to make it happen. This is Lee Ann Womack.
I hope you dance. I hope you dance.
And this is CMT Showcase. Born and raised in Jacksonville, Texas, Lee Ann Womack was much like the other kids in this tiny, rural East Texas town. But one thing set her apart. From the time she was barely able to walk, Lee Ann had only one dream, becoming a country singer. She also had the courage, faith, and passion to make that dream become reality.
You know, I don't remember any one moment when I decided I want to be a singer, because I don't ever remember not wanting to be.
She's definitely very focused. She's, you know, she's somebody who's thought about this a long time, even before she got to town.
You hear a lot of artists say, you know, I listened to the Grand Ole Opry when I was growing up. Or actually, I don't know if you do hear that much anymore, but I really did lie on the floor between the twin beds and put a speaker on each side so I could just sort of get lost in the music and lost in this station that was coming from Nashville. And it was a very, very real thing for me.
Liam was always really good about saying, this is what I want to do. I know what kind of music. I know how I want to look. I know how I want to sound. And obviously it's paid off for.
She can tell you who played on what record in, you know, 1985. And, you know, you're kind of going, 1985, let's see, you couldn't have been, you know, what, you were in high school or just getting out or whatever, you know, and you're just like freaking out going, you know, you were really a student.
When I was graduating from Jacksonville High School, I can remember the seniors all talking about going on a senior trip. They were going to South Padre Island. I talked my parents into kind of trading it out because everybody's parents were giving them the money to go on this senior trip. So my parents said they'd give me the money and I could go to Nashville. And I walked up and down Music Row. And so that was my first time to really get to see what the city that I had dreamed about all my life was like.
Lee Ann returned home and began planning how to get back to Nashville permanently.
I knew I wanted to come to Nashville. But I hadn't had enough experience in actually performing in the music business. So I went to Levelland, Texas, and signed up for classes at South Plains Junior College. Best thing I probably ever did for my career. There is a group of teachers out there who are professional musicians, and they've traveled with different groups and for years and played in the studio. They have a great recording studio out there. It was a wonderful place to be. And I actually got an education doing exactly what I do now.
After attending South Plains for a year, Lee Ann transferred to Belmont University, literally down the street from Nashville's famed Music Row. At Belmont, she finagled a way to get inside her favorite record label.
Now, I don't know how it works now, so don't be coming here trying to do it the way I did, because I'm sure they've fixed the loopholes. But there was a big bulletin board there at the school, and they had all the internships listed on little cards. And there was somebody looking for an intern who worked at MCA. So I just took the card down off the wall so nobody else would call about it. And instead of, you know, bothering with the school part of it, I just went on down to the label.
MCA was home to legendary producer Tony Brown, who produced acts like Reba and George Strait. Lee Ann determined to land the internship and meet the famous producer.
So when I went over there to interview for that position, I was trying to find a parking place, and it was in this little building, but they had a two-tier parking garage, and I had never been in a parking garage in my life. And so I was a little nervous, and somebody knocked on my window. And I looked over, and here is, you know, this gorgeous man, dressed to the nines. And I think, he's gonna tell me to get out of here. So I rolled out my window, and it was Tony. And I didn't know it at the time, but he said, hey, can I help you? I said, well, you know, and I told him what I was there for. And he goes, oh, here, just park right here. It's fine. I'll show you where you need to go. So I parked the car and got out, and I'm thinking, man, when I get in here, you know, Tony Brown's going to be in here somewhere, not knowing that that was him. So we get up, and we're waiting at the elevator for it to come, and I look over, and there's Steve Warner walking up, and I couldn't believe it. Oh, my gosh, it's Steve Warner. And then Steve goes, hey, Tony Brown. I was like, oh, my gosh, that's Tony Brown. I guess I was really a goob. But so I worked there for a year not getting any school credit or not getting paid unless I was doing some kind of special project when they were paid. But basically just to see what was going on. Open doors and see what was going on and inside all those doors. Paid off.
Coming up, Leanne's focus and drive take her to the top of the country music world. Showcase. After years of appearing in clubs around Nashville, Leanne Womack had developed into an amazing singer and songwriter. Her talent and commitment finally paid off at a performance where she was showcasing some of her songs.
I signed a publishing deal with Sony Tree Publishing. There was a guy over there named Pat McMakin who came out to a showcase and saw me and heard me sing Am I the Only Thing You've Done Wrong and a couple of other songs I had written.
One of the things you look for is direction and focus. And since I met Leanne, it was very clear that she was a very focused individual. She knew the kind of music that was what was her and what wasn't her. And that made the process much easier for us. To get her a record deal, because it wasn't a matter of having to create or invent something that wasn't there, because it was always there with Leanne. She always knew who she was, and she knew the kind of music she wanted to sing.
It was obvious that Leanne was ready for a major record deal. Sony Tree wanted to do a showcase for several labels.
But I told him, I said, now, I'm not looking for just any record deal. I want you to get the people from MCA and Decca out there. That's where I want to be. And they said, you want us to spend all this money and you only want to invite one label? I mean, that's crazy. Let's invite all the labels. That way we have a better shot. Nope. Don't want to be just anywhere. I want to be there.
She was very sure that she wanted to work with MCA or Decca, with Tony Brown or Mark Wright. She always loved the records that those guys made. She liked the way the labels handled their female artists.
I just really liked her voice. I said, that's... just, you know, it had a little bit of Dolly, it had a little bit of Alison Krauss, but it wasn't enough of either one to be on top of either one of them. It just had some real nice influences, and it was a Texas accent type thing, and just a very pure tone, and her pitch was impeccable.
I really think the turning point in the showcase was when we did Never Again Again. And we used the upright bass, and the fiddle and the steel and everything was just so country, three-part harmony. And I think that was really the point when Mark said, we gotta have this because nobody's doing this.
For a new artist, she was very, very ready when she started making records. She was ready. And a lot of times we have new artists making records and you say, you know, there's probably a couple albums away from really making their great album. But her first album was just killer. Just because she was ready.
Leanne's self-titled debut CD was released in May 1997. The first single from the album was the song that had helped land her deal, Never Again Again.
Never again, again. Once more I'll let you back in.
First time I heard Never Again Again, you know, I was hooked in.
I guess it was the song that introduced America to Leanne Womack. What a great singer she is, and I think she's just one of the great voices out there that still, you know, still blends the old sounds, but yet with the new sounds of country music as well. I'm a tremendous fan.
I love that whole album, and have been a fan since. And she's a real natural singer.
Boy, if I had not had Never Again Again out as my first single, I would not be still sitting here today. I really believe that.
Never Again Again established Leanne's reputation as an incredible traditional country singer. But it was The Fool that gave her her first number one record.
I got to do a full performance of that song at the CMAs the very first year that I was out as an artist. I came out that spring, and a few months later, I got to do the whole song at the CMAs. And the week that I did it at the awards, it had gone number one the day before. So it was a big week for my first award show. It's a big deal.
This is what we need right here, y'all. Miss Lee Ann Womack.
Leanne's second CD, Some Things I Know, was greeted with equally glowing response. It included the number one smash hit, Little Past Little Rock.
I'm a little past Little Rock, but a long way from over you.
A Little Past Little Rock was a big song for me. It was my first Grammy nomination, so it was very special. I think I had a lot of people that didn't normally like country music or didn't normally listen to country music that reached out to. And so it was a big, big song for me.
When you do something like Little Past Little Rock, it stepped up. It's still Lee Ann Womack, still sounds like Lee Ann Womack, but it's just a little fuller record. Which in turn, that obviously sets up something like I Hope You Dance.
As I was preparing to make the third record, I had taken quite a bit of time off and I knew it had to be great. I mean, I knew it had to be really, really special.
Leanne's brand new release, I Hope You Dance, has been hailed as her best project to date. However, she sees it not so much as a success for herself, but as a triumph for her entire team.
You know, it's not just about the artist. It's, you're one part of it, but so many people invest their time and their money and their connections and everything on you that I sort of felt like I wanted to make something that we could all, as a unit, be proud of.
For someone who has such strong ideas, her listening abilities are extraordinary. Because as we all know, most people who have very strong ideas are busy selling their ideas and not listening. And she's a great listener.
I think she's got a good team around her. She's got a great record company, an awesome manager, publicity, all the way down her hair and makeup, the girl that dressed her, everything's in line.
I have this thing in me anyway that enjoys being part of a team and winning as a team. When I was in high school and played tennis, I enjoyed playing doubles better than singles because when you won, you had somebody to celebrate with. And so when I was making this record, I wanted to know that I was going to have something that we could all celebrate together. So I hope they feel that way about it, but I think it's a very special project.
The title cut of the album, I Hope You Dance, is a celebration of hope and wanting the very best for someone else.
I hope you never lose your sense of wonder. You get your fill to eat, but always keep that hunger.
I heard I Hope You Dance, and I looked up, and I looked at the publisher. I said, I can't believe this song has not been cut. He said, well, it's brand new. And I said, it's never been cut. It's never been pitched. Never. Been, I can't believe we can get it right now. And he goes, it's brand new. I said, put it on hold. I got to play this for Leanne.
Frankly, I think her first single, I Hope You Dance, is easily a shot for single and song of the year. There's some good competition out there. Nashville and their artists are making some great music. But I think this one has a major shot.
It's one of my favorite pieces of work I've ever been involved in my entire career. Just because of what it says.
I heard it on the radio the other day, and then I changed channels, you know, stations, and I heard it again. And then I got up the next morning, turned on the radio, and heard SIX, and, you know, I heard it again. So I said, that gal's got a hit.
Coming up on CMT Showcase, an exclusive performance of Lynching CMT Showcase. Leanne Womack's passion and commitment to her craft may have made her a success, but it's her artistry and style that make her a favorite of both fans and fellow artists alike.
I can't say enough great things about Leanne. I think she's truly one of the best singers I've ever heard.
I think Leanne is a real talent, you know, and I think somebody that can really sing and pick songs well to write songs and make good albums.
I
think a lot of people can interpret a song, and then I think a lot of people know how to technically sing great, and Leanne's both. She's a great singer.
She just can sing about anything. She probably sing the phone book and make it sound good, but she's just has a lot of honesty in her voice, I think.
I think she can be here just as long as she wants it, and she cares deeply about the music, so that's a long time.
There is no point when I'll feel like, okay, I've accomplished it. You know, I think those of us who are so driven to win, whatever that means, never stop competing. We just keep going and keep going. And you know, I could set a goal to get here, but as soon as I get here, I'm looking on to the next the next goal. So, you know, I don't know, but I know that it's always bigger and better, and I'll, like I said, I'll keep doing it forever.
Thanks for watching CMT Showcase with Lee Ann Womack.